We do have a few announcements this morning that I'd like to cover. The Global Gates Missionary Team is something that we talked about in the missions team meeting. And they're meeting, there are 60 different missionaries are coming to Raleigh in the month of June. The mission team has decided to give two gift bags. One, they're not going to give a gift bag ourselves, but what they're asking is these 60 missionaries to receive a gift bag when they come into Raleigh to refurbish, to encourage, and to inspire. What the gift bag consists of is a $50 gift certificate, which is most of the cost of the gift bag. But the main thing they're wanting is letters from the church, letters from the Sunday school, letters from the mission team, or whatever, that saying, hey, we will going to be praying for you guys, and we really do support you. What they're doing, Global Gates, just so you know, is a mission team that is designated to North America large cities. Because as you know, immigrants are coming in from all over the world. So as far as go out through all the ends of the earth, you can really do that here in large cities. So if you're interested in doing that, next week we're going to ask for a special offer. And as you go out, we'll have a basket there, and the mission team has asked, if you want to give a donation and us to do more bags, that's entirely up to you. So do that if you like. If you would feel so led to give, we would take that contribution and give more gift bags. But right now, what Lambert Memorial Baptist Church has agreed to do is to do two gift bags at this time. Also, if you'll notice on the bulletin, if you notice on the overhead or on the slideshow that we had, we mentioned the Easter service. Well, the Easter service, sunrise service, is joint service with Concord, and we had thought it's going to start at 6:45. Well, it's going to start at 6:30. So we knew this after the fact. We'd already did the bulletins. We'd already done the slide. So the joint Sunday school or joint sunrise service with Concord is going to be at 6:30. And as you guys know, but I didn't know, they usually gather under the old oak tree. I thought that was kind of interesting. In the front lawn, that the sun rises across 57. They thought it would be just a beautiful, picturistic time that we're going to do. And your pastor, myself, is going to give the message that Sunday. So I know 6:30 is going to be early for some, early for most, early for all. So if you can be there, that'd be great. And with that, that's all of our announcements. I would just say, hey, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Prepare your hearts for worship. As we get ready to worship, I thought it would be an opportunity to read this card. I know that we do things differently, we serve differently, we are called differently to do different things, but one of the things we have done in our line of service is ministered to this family. And I thought as we prepare our hearts for worship that I'd read this card now. Dear Lambert Church family, on behalf of myself and my family, I'd like to thank you all for your kindness, support after my dad's passing. All the food, drinks, flowers, texts, cards, condolences, and prayers have been a blessing to us during this difficult time. Thank you. With love, Natalie Monroe, Mara, and family. Along those lines, I'd also like to think that this is one of the most celebrated times of the year. It is one of the most times that we think about cherishing Christianity forever. And I thought, what better way to embrace it when we have the palms, and thank you, Pam, for making sure the palms were here. Thank you, children, for bringing them forth. John 12:13 says this. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. It was the week of the Passover. There were thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people in Jerusalem. And they said, he is coming. He was Jesus Christ himself. There was a buzz in Jerusalem, all throughout Jerusalem, a buzz that he is coming, the one who had healed, the one who had saved, the one who had walked on water. Yes, even the one who had risen Lazarus from the dead, he is coming. The Savior, the Messiah, is on his way to Jerusalem. Their anticipation that day was that Jesus Christ was going to come and change their destiny forever. They thought Jesus Christ was going to come that day and was going to take over from Rome. And once again, the Israel nation was going to reign above all others in the earth. It didn't quite happen that way that day. From the way they had anticipated. But it doesn't mean that Jesus didn't do what he anticipated. This week is one of the most influential times in history. Jesus Christ himself rode in on a donkey and a colt, satisfying a prophecy, one that he would come. They were celebrating to crown the king without even knowing that the crown that he would bear would not be the crown of rubies and jewels, but the crown that we have listed or presented here on this cross, a crown of thorns. Join me as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, it's a holiday. Yes, we've celebrated this holiday many years, some of us. We've all came to the church services many years of Palm Sunday, the week before we celebrate Easter Sunday. Lord, may this week not be just like any other week. As we embrace every day and what it means of the walk of Jesus, today we celebrate the day that he entered that gate. Hosanna! Praise be the King of Israel! A celebration that was taking place. Only did they know the betrayal that was waiting for Jesus. Our Savior, Lord, Jesus, you knew that day of what it was going to mean for you. But through your obedience and through your love for us, we now have a life here on this earth as temporary, but our eternal life will be with you. where there will be no more sorrows. There will be no more pain because you've made a way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. It's nice to be home. The islands were beautiful, but it was nice to come home and get baby snuggles again. That little girl's so cute. If you don't mind, stand this morning and let's sing I'll Praise You Anywhere.
Sometimes you gotta dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta stare down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta you anywhere.
Everybody good? Well, let me ask you a question. Would you want to be famous? You would want to be famous? Yes, just think about it. Maybe not, maybe. Well, think about being famous. You get all these perks. Maybe you get, you know, a lot of pictures, go to restaurants, maybe have fancy cars. Yeah, Jeremy?
I just saw a wind-up car.
Okay, yeah. Do what, Jeremy? Oh, that is a good point. So some people might want to be famous, but some people just want to be normal, right? Just live a normal life. Well, what about Jesus? He was famous, wasn't he? I mean, he is. Millions of people know him. He is. So do you think he, when he was on earth, do you think he enjoyed all that extra stuff? No. Let me tell you, Jesus took on the role of a humble man. He, when he became famous, as people taught, as Jesus taught the word, yeah, he became famous, but Jesus was humble. He wore simple clothes, he ate simple foods, and he did not want all of the attention, not at all. You know, think about it. Jesus was on earth for, what, 30-some years, and he was sent as our Savior. And Jesus, even when Jesus knew he could perform miracles, he still didn't want the attention. All Jesus wanted to do was to love others and help others and teach the word of God, right? Well, guess what? That's what Jesus wants us to do. Jesus is in heaven, but he's always with us, right? And he wants us to be like him. He wants us to love everybody, be kind to everybody. He wants us to maybe not fight for the front of the line, maybe not want that very special present that you think you've got to have because you really don't need it. I had to say that. Jesus wants us to help and to love others. That's what he wants us to do. And you know what? We need to thank God for sending Jesus to save us, don't we? So remember that as you go back, enjoy your break, and as you go back to school, remember that with your friends. Remember to be kind to people. Remember maybe to include that person that nobody else is including. Remember maybe to take on new friends and to share your toys, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, can we say a prayer?
Yeah.
Okay. Dear Lord, thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for him as our Savior, Lord. Because of Jesus, we know what Christianity is. And help us to be better people and help us to guide these children. Amen. All right, who wants an Easter egg?
Yay!
Yay, dig in there and get one. There may be a surprise in there. Ooh, get one for your sister. Ava, get one for your sister. You can get one for them. Okay, go ahead. Hurry up. Let's get an egg, okay? There you go. Get an egg, Walkie. There you go. Oh, yes. Okay, good job.
The entire future right there. Lovely. Love the energy. If you will take your hymn books this morning and turn to 216, 4,000 Tongues to Sing, and please stand.
Let us pray. Father, as we prepare our hearts and our minds to remember that fateful day of your triumphant entry into Jerusalem, help us to also remember that it came at a great cost and a personal sacrifice. Father, we are reminded that there are few things in life that don't require cost. Help us to be diligent in the sharing of our tithes and offerings, that we too can secure the most effective means of glorifying your holy name. Amen.
As we receive our offerings, will you join me in singing the chorus of He is Lord? Please stand.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Today, I'll be reading from Philippians 2, 5 through 8. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage.
Today I've entitled today's sermon, What Makes a Good Role Model? I don't know if you know this or not, but you probably do, but every time, if you look at your Bible today, in verses 5 through 11, or in a different text, they're in a different font, they're highlighted differently. That usually means one or two things. It's either a poem or a song, and this was intended to be a song. And it's a point of worship. And we don't think about Paul a lot about songs and singing. But it is something that was memorized. So that's something else. You know, you think about the scripture, and I didn't intend to say this morning, but I think it's so important. Because one of the things that we learned when we were smaller was memorizing Bible verses. Some of us grew up that if you memorize this Bible verse, you might get some surprise, or you may get a prize, or you may get a check mark or a star put on your roll or whatever you are. But a lot of people memorized verses 5 through 11. It was something that they knew. It was something that they memorized. And the reason they did is for this particular time is because Jesus Christ gave us the role model of how to live our life. I think that's important. It's important for us to remember, and also important for us to embrace. And if you look at in your relationship to one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used in his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, and even death on the cross. Now, there's more to that story, but I want us to stop there for today. This morning, more than any other morning, for some reason, I have been deliberating within myself, debating, if you will. I wanted to print something. It wouldn't print. We got a new printer. Thank you, David. Brand new printer. I wanted to make sure the announcements was done correctly. I was on task to do the announcements today. I wanted to make sure that I did meet and greet each one of you today. Well, I didn't accomplish that today. But the end of the day is, today is Palm Sunday. And I was thinking how chaotic and how crazy life is sometimes about this or that. And I can remember as a young parent, and my children were small, I took advantage of every opportunity that I could take to go somewhere with my children. And a lot of times, guess when it was? Easter. Spring break. It used to be called Easter vacation, and we somehow changed it to spring break because it's now encompasses everybody, right? But what I want to talk about today is role models. And I am a role model, but so are you. We're all role models. Whether we embrace it or not, you are a role model. You influence people. You influence your children. You influence your neighbor. You influence everyone that you come in contact with. We all are role models. Now, some role models are self-proclaimed. Others are identified as role models because of their popularity, like heroes, sports stars, celebrities, actresses, politicians even. Then there are those that are selected as role models because of the good nature that they are, because of the love that they've given us. A lot of people, if I was to ask you, who was your role model and who is your role model, if it's easy for you to say, maybe not so much for me, they're not the same. I use this when I all through my work, all through my life career, especially when I became a supervisor. People used to say, well, he's your favorite, or she's your favorite. Or you just give all the attention to that person. Or you give all, and I say, yeah, it's a rotating position. I give my favoritism to someone different. It's a rotating position, and so is my role models. I mean, I can remember my role models being so different when I was a little lad, and then as I grew up, I tend to gravitate to role models being someone that I could connect with at that particular junction of my life. How about you? But I tell you something that I always did, whether conscious or not conscious, is I would compare myself to the best of the best. And guess what happens when you compare yourself to the best of the best? You always fall what? Short. And it is important for us to have a good self, not esteem, image. I used the word image today on purpose. Self-image, because there is no better image than we can ever shoot for than Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? But your self-image is so important. And your self-image can change at the flicker, just like this. All someone has to do is to come in and, oh man, they can really attack how you feel. They can, you know, it was a good day until... It was a good morning until I felt good about myself until I think their self-image says this. It affects how you feel about ourselves. It affects how you interact with others. It boasts your physical. It says it boasts your mental, your social, emotional, spiritual well-being. Your self-image boasts, if that's the right word, all of those. It makes us more open to new opportunities. It makes us more open to new experiences, because you could say, well, I can do anything. You just give me a little bit of a chance and an opportunity, I can do it. It helps us foster better social relationships and gives us a sense of contribution in life. I'd say that we are all role models of some sort of another. I'd say that regardless, we are role models, regardless we embrace it or not. Now, I get it. I mean, I do. When I start talking about being Christ-like, I mean, it sounds very holy and very religious, but shouldn't we all strive to be more Christ-like? And if we're going to be striving to be more Christ-like, it doesn't mean we end up Christ-like. It means that every day I get up and I try again to be more and more Christ-like. And when I fall short, guess what? I look in the mirror and say, God, you didn't make no junk. You made me exactly how I am, beautiful in your image. Am I good? No, I'm not good. Genesis, you know I love that verse where it says you're not good. You are very good. And you need to remind yourself of that. Your self-image is important. You are made perfect. You are molded exactly like he wanted. And you can accomplish all these great things that he has intended for you to accomplish without any doubt in his mind. But how about yours? I'm a little excited today. I am, because I want you to get it. I want you to get that you are a role model. You are here today, and some aren't. I understand that. But that doesn't mean that they're not role models and you are. It means that you are a role model, and you're doing all you can do, the best you can do every single day, and so are they. We can't look at people and tell them what they're not doing, and we can't look at people and tell them what they haven't doing, because guess what they can do to us? Well, you're there this week. I was there last week. You're not there. We all fall short, right? We celebrate Prom Sunday, and I love the way the children, I even love the fact that they had to keep coming. And then they had to go back and get more palms and had to come back, because it was part of what I consider a task. Because that's how life is sometimes. I got to check the box. I got to do the task. But no, it's more than that. What I embraced is, when I was watching them, is there was a parade about to happen. He is coming. He is coming. The scripture that I read in John 12:13 said he. It didn't say Jesus. I can remember my when I was writing papers and in seminary, and it said, don't you use he if you're talking about Jesus. Does he not deserve the worthiness of to be called by name? He? No, he says, do not use he. You use Jesus. Jesus is coming, the one who has healed, the one who has healed the mute. The blind can see. He walks on water. He calmed the storm. And yes, he even raised Lazarus from the dead. He is coming. He is coming. They had, if you saw the Chosen, it went flashback. Before the Chosen episode started, to David, King David coming in, and the reason they did that is so that we would know without question that that was the welcome for a victorious king or victorious army. As they entered the gates, the city gates, they welcomed with palm branches and they would yell, Hosanna. Jesus was the main attraction of that parade. They cheered him on as a hero, as a victorious king. They were anticipating something way different than what's going to happen the rest of this week. Have you ever been in a parade? Rode a float, marched in a marching band? Walk down the street on a group team if your daughter was in the parade. You know, some of the parents walk down beside them all the way down. You ever been in a parade? Small towns like Roxborough, I would think, embrace parades, or they used to. If they still don't, I think they used to. And the energy and the time that's put in a parade is enormous. If you've ever made a float, have you ever helped on a float? I mean, if you ever marched in a high school marching band, they don't just get out there and march. They practice hours upon hours upon hours of what they're going to do and when they're going to do it and when they're going to stop and when they're going to do this. It's a lot of effort. Maybe you like Wanda. You marched in the parades as a high school marching band, or in her case, as the flag girl, twirling the flag. If you've never been in a parade yourself, I'm sure you've watched parades. I'm sure you settle on the sidelines, and as they come by, you'd wave, or as you were a small child, you're just waiting for them to drop that candy. And the parents would say, hold it, wait, don't get run over. But grabbing that candy. What is the atmosphere like in a parade? It's noisy, there's cheers, it's loud. People were shouting as Jesus walked by, Hosanna! It was just not a normal day like we have today. I'm trying to paint you the picture. This is not a normal Sunday. It is the day that we're celebrating that changed our life forever. Jesus could have not entered that city, but once he entered that city, he knew his fate was sealed. If you've ever been in a parade as the grand marshal or the predominant role, you know, the homecoming queen, maybe some of you. Maybe you're the drum major, get all the attention. Maybe you're on Santa's float. I would assume that if you're one of those people, though, that it's easy for you to get your chest bowled up. You know, I'm the homecoming queen. You know, I'm the grand marshal. People coming to see me. I would assume that those marching or those that were hearing the noise and the yells and the, yay, it's Ricky, it's Heather, it's Tina, yay, it's Brandon. I'm assuming you were just,
yeah, that's me.
Adam is a friend of mine, he's a minister locally in North Carolina. He says, there was perhaps no parade in history that was more important than the parade that entered Jerusalem, Eastern Gate. Nowhere ever in the world, the way it's described in the Gospel of Mark 11. Jesus was the prophet from Galilee. the very Son of God. At one day, less than 30-some years ago, he was in heaven. And now he's riding in on a donkey or a colt. I like what Adam called it, a four-legged transport. Of course, most of us wouldn't have crossed our minds that they were watching what they were watching or witnessing today when they celebrated Jesus in a parade of what would happen just a few days later. For everyone that day in the crowd and probably that cleaned up after the parade thought it was triumphant. It was a victorious day as Jesus entered those cities. Well, not everyone. Jesus Christ himself knew very well what that week was going to mean. It was Passover. I could do a whole nother sermon on Passover, but it was Passover. There were thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people there celebrating Passover. And Jesus was coming in as the worthy lamb for another celebration, if you will, of Passover. In those days, I hope you got it, but kings entering the city that were cheered on were celebrating a past triumph, not a future triumph. Jesus was entering and they were celebrating a future triumph. And their anticipation of what that triumph looked like and Jesus knowing what the triumph looked like was nowhere the same. Jesus himself, though, understood the paradox, if you will, of Palm Sunday. And the victor parade, as he entered, as truly a humbled king. A humbled God. God. A humbled God. We don't use that name enough to describe Jesus. God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He was a God. Not a God, the God. So what? I asked myself, I got it wrote down, so what? So what, Pastor? So what? What does that mean to me? 2,000 plus years ago, Jesus rides in on a four-legged transport. I like that. So what? What does it mean today? We're not talking about Easter Sunday. We're talking about today. What does that mean today? So what? Well, you got a chance to shine as a role model today. Because I want you to celebrate today. And I want you to make sure that you're celebrating today with someone. And I don't know how you're going to do it. I don't know if you're going to text them, call them, nudge them beside you. I don't know how you're going to do it. But you got a chance to influence somebody. Today starts the week. Today starts the week. Today starts the week. I know we're going to celebrate Easter. Some of you are going to be there sunrise, some of you ain't. Some of you are going to be here Sunday, some of you ain't. But today marks the week. Jesus was riding in on a colt, and they were waving palms, and they were shouting Hosanna. They were giving him all the praise for what he was due because of not what they knew he was going to do, but what he knew he was going to do. And we're celebrating because we read the rest of the story. They didn't know, as Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story, but we do know the rest of the story, that Jesus He knew someone was going to betray him. Someone he loved. He knew even the person that he was going to put the foundation of the church was going to deny him three times. He knew that a wooden cross one day, something that he created, he was going to have to carry down the streets. I used the example about role models and rotating positions I'd put names on it, like teachers, coaches, grandfathers, fathers, mothers, siblings, brothers and sisters in some kinds, be your role model, president, scientist, some of your managers, your mom, your dad. Sometimes my children just show me how to be a role model better than I could ever show them. So I challenge you today to say, you're my role model. Let me tell you why. Tell someone. And then it gives you an open door. Today we celebrate the week of Easter. Yeah, we've been through Lent. But today we're kicking off this week. Every day should be a focus of every day should be a focus of every day should be the focus of Jesus, knowing that he knew when he went entered that city, he would not walk out. Not as a human. His life on this earth was going to end in 7 days or whatever day. Someone do the math. 5 days. How many of us would live differently if we knew we had 5 days to live? We used to celebrate, a lot of you might remember this, that Easter offering was what was it called? Annie Armstrong. We used to celebrate this all the time. Annie Armstrong, rally cry was go forward. She emerged as a powerful leader when she turned her energies to unity and women and pulling women together and said, we can make a difference. Yes, women. She was born in 1850 and to 1938, so we're talking many years ago, but she united women. She knew that women could make a difference. And some of us know now that women can make a difference. And she was a role model because she said, women, we can make a difference. She went up all the way into high office of the mission board. And yes, she was a woman. I say that to say we embrace that here at Lambert Memorial Baptist Church, that women, yes, women can lead. She was a great role model. She was one that just established the missions offering like you can't believe. And when missions was going all over the world to spread the gospel, Annie Armstrong was one of the greatest ever, men or women, man or woman. She was one of the greatest. She is one of the greatest role models that you could ever say she was a role model. She was founded and served as president of the Women's Baptist Home Mission Society in Maryland in 1882. She also served on the Women's Missionary Union, WMU. She helped start it. She was the WMU. Under her leadership, she established a library, a reading room that expanded to become published and distributed missions literature all over the world. That's where the literature came from that saved and responsible for saving that men and women all over the world. Ronald Reagan, for you men. Ronald Reagan chose a man to be his role model. I didn't know this, but his role model was Franklin Roosevelt. So Annie Armstrong, do you know who her role model was? Her mom. She says her mom was her role model because she loved people and she knew the meaning of helping people learn about Christ. It can be your mom. It can be another president. Picking role models can be important. We read most recently in your Sunday school, if I peeked through some of your Sunday school lessons, you talked about Noah, you've talked about Abraham, we've talked about Esther, we've talked about Ruth. We talked about all kinds of role models in the Bible. And do you know that your story, it's not made it in this Bible, but your story is written down in heaven. Your story is written down in heaven by name. By name. And you have a responsibility to be a good role model here on earth because everything that you have done, good or bad, has been written down. And I hate to say that, good and bad. I hate to say it. For me, I feel bad about that because there's some of the things I wished it weren't written down. One commentary suggests this is, we should have a Christ mindset, not to grasp at the glory, but to live, to love, to die, and to empty oneself. That's what Jesus did. Paul writes a lot about Jesus, about his love for us, about his desire for us to live in unity, about Jesus' humility. We ought to remember we are called to do, we're not called to do life alone, but we're called to do life together. I've mentioned it many times, and I love the acronym, and you already know it, some of you, but teamed together, everyone achieves more. Lambert Memorial Baptist Church, we are not going to accomplish what God wants us to accomplish unless we are in total unity and together working toward the same goals, common goals, and together everyone achieves more. There should be no long rangers in the Christian faith. We're not here alone. We're not dependent on what our strength and weaknesses are. God has put us here for this purpose and this time. And Philippians 2 is all about what we do together and not separately. Because we need each other to be faithful to our covenant of God and follow the example of Jesus, our one and only and true role model. We need each other to be successful because life is not easy. We need to encourage each other because your self-image is important. And the last thing that I want, anything, the last thing I want is anything that I say or do to somehow pierce in to your doubt about your self-image. You should say the same to your fellow congregants or to your fellow members and your fellow community. We get enough of negativism without coming to church and hearing negative. And I'm not preaching to you. I'm preaching with you. I'm talking to me. I have been convicted this week by my Lord and Savior to say yourself, you are a role model. What kind of role model are you perceiving? What kind of perception of you is out there? Jesus faced betrayal, anguish, abuse, tortures, death, and all remembers he went anyway. Why? Because he loved us. In closing, Jesus knew what he's facing. He started it this week. I challenged you, just to be clear, I want you to be clear what I'm challenging you to do, is that you are a role model. What is your self-image? What is God convicting you on? What can you improve? And I'm challenging you to do this. Reach out to someone this week and tell them, you are my role model, and this is why. They might need a shot of positive self-image. They just might. Because the wise man once said, if you greet everyone that you meet in this world, 85% of them, if you greet them like they're hurting, like they're suffering, like they're going through difficult times, 85% of the time, you are right. I don't know what you're going through this week. I don't know what your busy schedule has you to go through this week. But I want you to know this. You are a role model. Your self-image matters. Believe me, don't listen to what the world says about you. Read what God says about you. You're not good. You're very good. Paul urges the Philippians to do the work, the same work, same sort of work that Jesus did. For it is God that is active in them. Continue to work out your salvation, he says, for it is God who works in you and through you, and is the strength of God that gives us, that makes us capable of doing, not us. When we feel like we're worthy, we're weak, or we're not worthy, remember that it's not us that does the work, but it's him who does it through us. When we allow the God to work in us and give us the same mindset as Christ and strive to get the same mindset of Christ, uniting with other believers and under united with the hearts of people that love you and care for you and will not just cast you to the side. And I'm challenging us to do one thing, and maybe this came to me right now. It's not written down here, but I've made a couple of challenges this week with a couple of people, and one I started with myself. is I am going to try my best, and I'm not good at it, but I'm going to try my best, and I know it's going to be impossible, but I'm going to try my best to avoid any negativism coming from my mouth. If I've got something to say to you and it's negative, I'm going to not say it. And if it means there's a void in my sentence and you don't understand what I'm talking about, fine. I am not going to tell you negative stuff. I'm going to try my best and live this week. If not, maybe I can do it one day at a time. Maybe I can do it 1 hour at a time. Maybe I can do it 1 minute at a time. But I'm going to strive to not be negative. I'm going to strive to be positive because I want to be more Christ-like. I can't even imagine Jesus coming in here today and telling you all the things you're doing bad. I can imagine Jesus coming here if Jesus was to come in here today, there would be this great revival. And I know there'd be a great revival because he would be able to look you dead in the eye. There'd be something different. You could see something in his eyes because there's a genuine love. Can you do that this week? Can you give genuine love this week? Can you only give positive voice and a positive outlook this week? I don't know if you can, but when you fail, try to do it again. If you fail, you get down and you may fall down on one knee, but you get up. If I was playing sports, my coach would say, get up. If I got knocked down, they said, get up. And I want you to get up and I want you to strive again because God is on a mission. He doesn't need us. He wants us. He's not calling you for what you're capable of today. He's calling you for what you're capable of tomorrow. He sees in you something great. He sees your self-image that's worthy, that's worth, that has self-worth. He sees it. I'm excited today because I'm going to tell you why I'm excited. If this world knew the importance of today, they would have stopped what they're doing and they'd have been here or there. But they don't see it. They don't. If this world saw the value in being here, to being in church, if they saw value for their children to plug them in and learning scripture and learning Bible, so if they saw value in it, you couldn't beat the door. For some reason, we've lost value. We've talked about a parade on Palm Sunday, how it being the most important parade ever on this earth. But our heavenly parade, now that's a parade. I want to wave at you when you go by. And I want to celebrate. Hey, how you doing, Jennifer? Hey. How you doing, Jay? And I want you to boast out then. Because that'd be worthy. That's going to be worthy of you to say, yes, I have made it. You got homework. Your homework is simple. You are a role model. I don't know what you got to do to convince yourself, but convince you. And when you call, text, write, nudge someone beside you and tell them, hey, you're my role model, and let me tell you why. They just might need a shot in their self-image. As we close today, I'm going to sing wherever he leads, I'll go. And I'd like to offer you a prayer this morning before we sing. And then if there's something that you would like to bring to the altar, bring. I didn't do a good job. If you're a visitor and you haven't filled out a visitor's card, please do that. But the main thing about it is if you're here today, I hope you heard this one thing. You are a role model. And you have a responsibility that God's given you with the people he's put in your life to be a good one. Let's pray. Dear my Father, I'm not sure why you've convicted me today, but you have. And I apologize to my church today. if I appear to be emotional. But Lord, I do know that you're telling me that we're role models. And it starts first with us believing we're role models. And it starts second with us believing we're worthy to be a role model. And I believe there's people out here today and even online that maybe don't feel worthy to be called a role model. Lord, will you somehow let everybody know before they leave here today that they are worthy? And Lord, I don't know. There's not a lot of good news out there in the world today. What a great thing it would be if everybody here would just go up to someone this week and say, I don't know if you know this or not, but you're my role model. And this is why. And I want to thank you because of what you showed me. You've given me something to strive for, to be better. Thank you, Lord. Forgive me this prayer for me. And I hope I've somehow given it to someone else. And we pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people would say. Amen.
Look at turn to 285, wherever he leads, I'll go.
Good day in the house of the Lord. Amen. I hope you received it today, and I hope you received it loud and clear. You are worthy. You are worthy to be called a role model. You are a role model. God has designed you to be perfect in exactly everything that He's intended you to be, and you are that. Claim it. Name it. Live it. Do it. Have I told you I loved you lately? I love you. Go in peace. Thank you.